नौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक्प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथो बलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्म उपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्म निराकुर्यां मामा ब्रह्म निराकरोद निराकरणमस्त्व निराकरणं मेस्तु। तदात्मनि निरतेय उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः।
वी विल बिगिन विथ चैंटिंग ऑफ केनोपनिषद।
केनेषितं पतति प्रेषितं मनः केन प्राणः प्रथमः प्रैति युक्तः केनेषितां वाचमिमां वदन्ति चक्षुश्रोत्रं कौ देवो युनक्ति श्रोत्रस्य श्रोत्रं मनसो मनो यद्वाचोह वाचगोऽसौ प्राणस्य प्राणः चक्षुषश्चक्षुरतिमुच्यधीरा प्रेत्यास्माल्लोकादमृता भवन्ति न तत्र चक्षुर्गच्छति न वाग्गच्छति नो मनो न विद्मो न विजानीमो यथैतदनुशिष्यात् अन्यदेव तद्विदितादथो अविदितादधि इति शुश्रुमपूर्वेषां येनस्तद्व्याच चक्षिरे यद्वाचानभ्युदितं येन वागभ्युद्यते तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धिनेदं यदिदमुपासते यन्मनसा न मनुते येनाहुर्मनोमतम् तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धिनेदं यदिदमुपासते यच्चक्षुषा न पश्यति येन चक्षुघोषि पश्यति तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धिनेदं यदिदमुपासते यच्छ्रोत्रेण न शृणोति येन श्रोत्रमिदगो श्रुतम् तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धिनेदं यदिदमुपासते यत्प्राणेन न प्राणिति येन प्राणः प्रणीयते तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धिनेदं यदिदमुपासते।
Spiritual sadhana is a confluence of head and heart. What the intellect understands, the mind is supposed to feel. What the mind is feeling emotionally, the intellect must try and understand. It is this combination that will take us through the ignorance towards the self. Mere intellection without any devotion may lead to arrogance that I know. Also, it will lead to confusion because depth of the understanding will not be there. So much length will be gathered by mere learning. Mere feeling without backing of understanding may lead to fanaticism and rigidity. So, ideal combination is to combine both devotion and intellection. That is why throughout the Vedas, throughout the Upanishads, what is given after pinpointing what Brahman is. When I say pinpointing, giving a pointer towards the direction of what Brahman is for us to understand intellectually, for us to think and contemplate and meditate upon it. Various types of upasanas are given. Upasana means worship. Upasana literally means, upa means near, asana means seat. So that practice which makes our mind gets seated near Brahman, where you are sitting near Brahman as it were, you means your mind, that practice is called as upasana. It is called as worship. Generally, two types of upasana are given. In Keno Upanishad, both are mentioned. As we said in the first class, and it is mentioned in the book, that part 1 and 2 deal with Nirguna Brahman, part 3 and 4 deal with Saguna Brahman. Brahman is Brahman, there is no difference. But Brahman in its purest form is Satchitananda, is the Nirguna Brahman. Brahman, when it is understood with gunas, it is called Saguna Brahman. So therefore, the worship is also twofold. There is Nirguna Upasana and Saguna Upasana. In this portion, he is giving us an indication through the same knowledge that he has given as to how to convert our activity into worship, which is Nirguna Upasana. And the mantras that are coming to say that these five mantras, it is not to condemn the Saguna Upasana, but to understand that one needs to use it as a means to get beyond it. That is the reason for which it is given as an emphasis. What is Saguna Upasana? Upasana, as I said, is worship. Guna means quality, sa means with. So you are worshipping Brahman with qualities. That is called Saguna Upasana. What is used for Saguna Upasana is called as Murti or Pratik. There are various terms to describe it. In English, the term used is idol, but it has a different connotation. But if we understand the spirit, that is what it means. That Brahman which cannot be conceived, that which cannot be felt or perceived, as it was given in the mantras that we discussed. How is it that you are to think of it and go near it? It is impossible. That is why for majority of people in the world, we need something to represent Brahman. That representation of Brahman will be made of something that is made in the world, of the elements of the world. But slowly, upasana is to make us forget what it is made of and to remind of what it is essentially. See, when a game of chess is there, you teach chess to a very young boy or a girl. There are various pieces in the chess. Then you say, this is king, this is queen, this is bishop, this is pawn. So, in the initial stage, the child is picturizing the coins of the chessboard as king or a queen. And you say, this is army, this is going to fight, etc. So that piece which is the tallest there, which is the king, or the next one which is the queen, is a representation of what a king is or a queen is. So therefore, in the initial stage, your imagination of king which is projected upon the piece is essential, and that is the first step. Without that piece, the child cannot imagine. Therefore, the representation is very much essential. Exactly like that, to start an initial spiritual aspirant into the spiritual path, you take him to the temple or you take him to the Durga Puja Pandal, and you say there is a Murti there. That is called as God. That is the goddess. So therefore, with that form, the child is able to understand or is able to conceive that God is this. And then the practice or the relationship begins with that person along with that God. As we proceed further in the upasana, what really should happen and what really happens for real seekers is, we understand that the God or your concept of what you are worshipping is not confined to that boundary of that murti. That is the initial stage that is required for us to understand that this is the reality. So therefore your imagination is posted upon that murti. Then when you are able to understand that concept of all-pervading reality, that all-pervading reality has taken this form and standing here will be the later understanding. There is a subtle difference. In the first case, you see the element upon which you are imposing God. Then you are able to understand God, feel God by your sadhana, and still you have not grown out of it. You may still need it for your concentration, you may still need it for your sadhana, but there is a subtle difference in understanding that God is not confined to that alone. God is all pervading. It is that which is all powerful. It is that which is all knowing. That is the understanding or your closeness to God that will be there. And yet you may still continue to worship whatever you are worshipping. You may still go to a temple. You may still have that murti, etc. You may still worship a fire or something. Whatever is the pratima. And remember this. Though the pratima or the idol is made up of any of the five elements, this we have discussed before, according to the subtlety, the grossest is the clay or the stone idol, which is made up of earth. It is the grossest because all the five elements, all the five senses can contact it. Nose can smell earth. Nose is the element associated. Nose is the smell is associated only with earth. Then you can taste it, you can see it, you can feel it with the touch, you can hear the sound, etc. Then you have the water. Water, four elements, four senses can contact it. Then fire. Fire, three senses can contact it. You can see it, you can feel it with touch, you can hear the sound. That is why fire, being the first element of sight, is worshipped across all religions. Then air. And then finally, subtle element of sound, which only ears can hear, which is associated with space. So in meditation, when you use the mantra Om, that is also representative of the self. So any of the elements can be used, or a mixture of all those things can be used for you to get concentration upon that reality, so that you can use it for your worship or devotion, so that a feeling is generated. But the caution is that do not get stuck to it. You have to finally transcend it. It will be transcended. That must be the aim or motive. Not only the elements of the external world that can be used as a means for your worship. You can do that puja or worship even internally. Whatever is told as dhyana or meditation, many a times people are able to get that single pointed concentration or meditation only with a form. That form is also made up of the same thing, but it is mental. Don't think that it is your imagination. It is just not, yes, obviously it is part of your thought, means it is imagination. But just as by constant worship, see, why do people get so inspired when they go to Tirupati Balaji temple or Vaishno Devi temple or Dakshineshwar Kali temple or any temple for that matter? The same murti can be in your home and you may daily see it also. Yet people want to make an elaborate plan and visit that once a year, some Somnath temple, somewhere they go. What is the difference between that Balaji and the Balaji that is there in your house? What is the difference? By constant worship of the people, by your own intensity of worship when you go there, when you completely forget yourself, what is being created there is an aura of spirituality which cannot be easily replicated anywhere. Now, if your mind is of such a high stage of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, anywhere you turn, Kali will appear. That stage will come at a later stage. But for initial inspiration, we do need to go to some places where there is a conducive atmosphere for us to get that feeling. That is why this country till today is blessed with various such places. It is temples, it is samadhis of great Mahatmas, or it is living places of great saints, whatever be it. It is the aura of that person, the place, and the number of devotees, etc., who go there. It is just not the quantum. Even qualitatively, when you go there, your feeling actually changes there. So the spiritual deposit, as it were, in those places are very high compared to other places. It is possible that you can create it in your own houses also. We are not saying it is not possible, but that much of tapas is required, that much of intensity is required. Now, if you are able to get that inspiration there like that, that much of inspiration is required for us to remind us of divinity. And finally, you have to understand that it is not an end in itself. In other words, it should not happen that finally you take a list of all the pilgrimage centers and then you will be agitated, these are the places I have not gone. So the whole worship makes you into more worrisome thing. That should not, you can just go to even one place or one thing which inspires you, but the whole idea is to fill the mind with divinity. This is called as Saguna Upasana, a upasana or worship for which you are able to. What is guna? Guna means, don't understand guna to be this sattva, rajas and tamas gunas. These gunas belong to prakriti, which belongs to individual, all of us. It belongs to the matter. Brahman doesn't have any of these gunas. It is beyond these gunas. It is spirit. The guna that is said is very special and exclusive for Brahman only. Gunas like in Ramayana, Rama is said to have got Kalyana Gunas. This Kalyana Gunas is a special term used like this only. Gunas like all pervasiveness, gunas like all knowing, all powerful, Ashraya for all, who is a refuge for all. These type of gunas are very exclusive for Ishvara only, for God only, for Supreme Lord only. So, for which, if you are able to imagine it with a form, etc., it becomes easy for the mind to worship. So, this portion of Keno Upanishad is not trying to condemn this worship. It is only trying to make us understand that it is not an end in itself. You have to go beyond it. That is why a personal experience for most of us who go to temples, I am not talking about those, maybe some foreigners who come there without knowing what it is, or they come as a tourist, automatically the eyes close at the climax of what you can call as aarti or darshan there. In fact, you have taken all the efforts to go there for darshan, and you do have darshan, but automatically sometimes the eyes close there. Why does the eyes close? The eyes closes, it's a natural unconscious feeling that what you are seeking is actually inside. The eye is actually seeing inside. And for seeing it inside, we need this elaborate preparation outside. So, as we saw in the fourth chapter of Gita, it gives a formula by which how you can convert each and every activity of yours, whether it is perception, emotion or thought itself, into worship. If we get into that introverted stage, that person may not need a elaborate pilgrimage or various rituals and other things to get that inspiration, because that inspiration is there for him at every stage of life, at every moment, at every experience. So, the aim of these five mantras given here is not to condemn the worship of the masses, because very interestingly, same Upanishad in the fourth part, it is going to say Tadvanam iti upasitavyam. Worship that as Tadvanam it is going to say. These five mantras it is going to say Nedam yadidam upasate, Nedam yadidam upasate. Five times it is going to repeat. So, I am just giving the background to understand the context. Because per se, if you take it and blow away all the temples and idols, because Upanishad has said, you have to understand to whom it is addressed. Again, we have to remind, the first portion of Upanishad is addressed to the highest caliber of students who have been given the highest knowledge available to mankind. It has Anyat evatat vidita tado avidita tadi. After that, it is saying Nedam meditam upasate. There ends the first chapter. Nirguna Upasana, on the other hand, is to directly worship Brahman as it is. It is rather very difficult, but that is the most direct method. There is no second thought on it. Blessed are those who are able to do this. What Brahman is, what we have understood in this mantra so far is that Brahman is that which makes you see. Brahman is that which makes you hear. Brahman is that which makes you smell, that which makes you think, etc. So therefore, what we consider of ourselves now to be this matter, vestures of body, mind and intellect, I am not that. I am that which makes these body, mind and intellect function. So if this thought is there, it is again not just at the thought level, an intense repetition by which you get a feel of it, little bit at least a feel of it, that becomes a upasana. So that upasana is to, because directly you cannot catch Brahman. In Saguna, at least you have a form or something to meditate upon. Here, what is the meditation upon? How can you do it? So it is only the question of negating what is not Brahman and asserting that which is Brahman. That which is really not visible to us, but that which is Brahman. So that which is Brahman, to assert it, we need some indication or a pointer. That indication or pointer is with reference to our own experience. Our own experience is sight, smell, etc. So instead of getting caught up in the sight or smell or mind's feelings or intellect's thoughts, etc., turn the attention towards what makes you see, what makes you hear, what makes you think. That alone is Brahman. That alone is Brahman. Not what people worship here. Not what people worship here. This is what he is going to repeat 5 times. Actually, Upanishads have a style of being very brief. It is not the style of Upanishads to be repetitive at all. Very, very brief. In fact, Ishavasya Upanishad, you are going to see, Karma Yoga is given in just one sentence, something like that. That's how they deal with it. It's not an elaboratory text. But wherever repetition is given, that means there is a very important message. That is what is to be understood. There is a depth of the message for us to remind. Sometimes some repetitions are given. Another trivia about repetition is, usually we have seen Upanishad is a conversation between master and the student. So the student asks the question and master gives the answer. That collection is called as Upanishad. So when the master finishes the lesson, sometimes he repeats the last sentence so that to make you understand the class is over. So to say that also repetition is there. Otherwise, repetition in the middle of the Upanishad is to emphasize on a particular point which is very important. So that is why the background is given like this. So this portion of Upanishad is actually taking us directly to Brahman. What is Brahman is explained to the head in the previous mantras. Now this mantra is also in fact saying the same thing, exactly the same thing. Meaning wise there is no difference, but why it is given is to make us do that upasana of the same. To not just understand it intellectually, but take us also through heart, through the same thing. Mantra 5. Yes, sir.
Question, sir. So, 5 elements, 5 organs of perception.
Yes.
And sound is the most subtle.
Right. Yes.
So can we say that ear is the most important organ of perception?
It is the subtlest organ of perception. Subtle, in the order of subtlety, we say ear first, then skin, eyes, like that. Only in the order of, because how they relate with the elements.
So what are the different subtle and importance? I mean,
No, importance in the sense you cannot that way classify. Even Upanishad is talked about as the head of Vedas, Shruti Shiras it is said. Head is the most important organ of the body. But you cannot say head alone will survive by itself. The limbs, everything is required. But in terms of if head is not there, it is not there. You know, the real essence of the thing is head. So like that, you cannot classify organs of that way. You can only say intellect. Intellect is the subtlest. Then mind, and then the organs of perception are subtler, then the organs of action. one test that you can keep is without what organ you can survive easily. That's all. Without legs you can survive. Without hands also you can survive. But of these two, hands are more important. The test is you ask yourself, if you are given a choice between living with legs and living with hands, what will you choose? That is a eyes and hands means you will obviously choose eyes. Ears and eyes also means you will choose eyes, right? So that way, in terms of what is closer to you, nearer to you, is in terms of in this sense only you can take. But strictly speaking, ear is more important than eyes, or eyes is more important. That way, you cannot classify in organs of perception.
Sir, second question. So, as we were discussing, Brahman is beyond nirguna and saguna, beyond finite and infinite.
No, nirguna and saguna is not finite and infinite. Please. Nirguna, Brahman is Brahman. Brahman is the supreme entity, Lord, whatever is inconceivable, it cannot be expressed in words, whatever it is. That Brahman, when it is as it is, in its pristine form, it is Nirguna Brahman. When it is understood with the quality, see, when you talk about Ishvara as the supreme Lord, it is the same Brahman. Let there be no doubt about it at all. There is no two Brahman, etc. Then we are, basic foundation itself is shaken. With reference to the world, when we understand, we are identifying ourselves as individuals now, right? So we are segregated from Brahman, and then we have an entire universe in front of us, which is the two things. This microcosm and that macrocosm, which is the universe, both are beautifully functioning according to a particular order set by somebody. That order is Brahman only. That is Supreme Lord is called as Ishvara. This Ishvara is understood in connection with these two. Therefore, he is called Saguna Brahman. He, by itself, it is there, because Brahman doesn't need a world or universe or anything to exist, as it were. So, it is Nirguna Brahman. Nirguna Brahman and Saguna Brahman are one and the same. There is no difference. If you are able to conceive it as it is Nirguna Brahman. If you are able to conceive it with all the gunas associated with this, because all pervading means, where does it pervade? Space must be there. He is the ruler of all means, there must be somebody who is ruled also, right? So, therefore, to Lord of all, that means all is there and therefore he is Lord of all. All this comes only when the discussion of microcosm, macrocosm, all these things are there. So, Brahman, when it is conceived by us in this form, it is called Saguna Brahman. Otherwise, it is Nirguna Brahman. Both are one and the same. There is no difference between the two.
Okay. So, sorry, just for that part, so what I am trying to understand is, Brahman is beyond pairs of opposites. So then, on one hand is Saguna, other hand is Nirguna.
No. Pairs of opposites belong to the world. Saguna and Nirguna don't belong to the world. Brahman is beyond the world. So, pairs of opposites don't come there.
In terms of finite, infinite, it comes in.
Yes. Infinite is also an intellectual concept. That way, infinite and finite are the ultimate pairs of opposites. With reference to your intellectual concept, and God cannot be captured in your intellectual concept. That's why we said it is beyond the known and the unknown there. Yes, sir.
The second line is repeated again 5 times. In that, there are two times the word idam is used. The first idam and the second idam. I'm not sure whether I have understood it.
No, we haven't come to fifth mantra, we'll chant it. Yes.
Sir, in the fourth verse, in the commentary, Swamiji has beyond the material world and
paragraph, please.
Fourth paragraph.
Yeah.
Second line, beyond the material world and even the enlivening principle. And then on the page 29, on second line, he has said, first line, Brahman is pure consciousness which supports all these states, enlivens them. So, in one place we are saying beyond the enlivening principle, and over here it is becoming the enlivening principle.
I hope you have read throughout.
Maybe I got a little stuck somewhere, I'm sorry.
It is given in the first, what the reference that you quoted, what we mentioned in detail, this first interpretation. The second line that you quoted comes under the second interpretation. And then comes the third interpretation. So, in the first interpretation, Brahman is in a way, that is the highest interpretation. And that is Kshara Akshara Uttama Purusha, that interpretation. Second is with reference to microcosm. In microcosm, the known is the matter of body, mind, intellect. Unknown is the vasana, and that which is beyond the known and unknown is that enlivening principle. So the interpretation holds good, but you are mixing the two interpretations, therefore there is a contradiction.
Next question is, what is the
Unknown and unknowable stick to the first interpretation. The vasanas is the second interpretation. Try to think on it from the first interpretation point of view. That's how you should understand this. Unknown and unknowable. Infinite is unknown, but that I know that it cannot be known is somewhat in your known concept. Don't confine it to intellectual concept, therefore it is unknowable. That is how it should be understood. So it is this known, unknown and unknowable. Again, when you use the term unknowable, I know it is unknowable, you know, it becomes as though that we can know it in some form or the other. It is just not possible to fit it into your intellectual concept. In fact, I am reminded whenever we do, even in our course, questions like this are bound to come again and again. And that is the message that Upanishad is giving. In and through all this explanations and the mantras, we are actually trying to go near it and capture it, but it eludes our grasp every time. That is the purpose of it. Then finally you stand aghast and say, my God, no, that sort of a thing. So known, unknown and unknowable are understood with reference to Kshara, Akshara and Uttam Purusha. So don't bring the vasanas in this context. Yeah.
Is it
possible
to say we'll
chant twice mantra 5.
यद्वाचानभ्युदितं येन वागभ्युद्यते तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यद्वाचानभ्युदितं येन वागभ्युद्यते तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते.
That which cannot be expressed by speech, that by which speech is expressed, know that alone to be Brahman, not this. This which people worship, two times this is given. Somebody asked, yes, this is what. So, nicely translated, we must say, by Swamiji, that he has mentioned both the time this. So, as I said, five times hammering is going to be there in these five mantras. Same meaning, same spirit, only he is going to change the equipment in every mantra, and you will also find these same five equipments are used in the from the first mantra onwards. First mantra students is using these five equipments. Master is starting to answer with that same five equipments, and he is going to continue the Upanishad with the same five equipments only. So what is this which makes the eye see, ears, prana, mind and speech? The same five thing. And it's not confined to the five, it is representative. Here also, speech is one organ of action. It is usually the style of Upanishad also to give one or two as samples to cover everything. Usually for organs of perception, eyes and ears are given, or sometimes ears are only given. It covers all the organs of perception. Usually for organs of action, speech is the subtlest, speech is given and that covers everything. Now, what this mantra says is, that which cannot be expressed by speech, that Brahman cannot be expressed by speech. In fact, words fail to convey what that real God is. We are going to see a literal proof of that in the next part. In the next part, the words of the mantras, when we take it translation, literally the words break and they cannot convey it as though gives a very contradictory meanings. But what we need to understand is that they are trying to express something which cannot be expressed, which is bound to fail. In terms of expression, it is the subtlest which is Atman. Even intellectual concept cannot be expressed by words. You need formulas, you need signs. Lesser than that is emotion, even that cannot be expressed by words. Emotion can, or rather if you express the emotion, it is usually surface emotion. Deeper the emotion, you cannot express any emotion. Anger or jealousy or love cannot be expressed when it is really there. Gratitude. What can be expressed probably is physical description. That also is possible, but nothing compared to your own experience. Your experience of seeing Taj Mahal, when you describe to your friend, he can maximum imagine. But that is comparatively easy when you try to express emotions, etc. And yet, great poets of great caliber have captured emotions. Great scientists and others have captured thoughts by their science and formula. But when it comes to capturing that which is beyond all these things, words cannot do any justice. So he says, that which speech cannot capture, but that which makes the speech function, that which makes the organ of speech function, that is Brahman. So what you speak is not Brahman. What makes you speak is Brahman. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa was asked this only. There was a great scholar, and Paramahamsa in that terms is not a great scholar as a pundit as other great scholars are, but he is a jnani. So he called Paramahamsa for a debate and asked him to debate on Brahman. They usually do that. He asked Paramahamsa, what is Brahman? He asked for his explanation. Only one word he said. How do you say it in English? I don't know. Jhuta, how do you say? You cannot say. There's no word. That which your saliva cannot touch, that is Brahman, he said. Saliva cannot touch it, that means I cannot open my mouth and speak. That's all he meant. If I speak, it is not Brahman. So he is asking to debate about Brahman and explain Brahman. He said, the saliva cannot touch it. That means you cannot speak about it. That's all it is. That is a jnani. Other scholars will debate like that. They will quote Upanishads. They will quote various things. And they will try to prove and arrive with a formula. Everything they will do. But a jnani only says this. Because he is not saying from any Upanishad. He is speaking from his experience. And that is Brahman. Brahman is that which makes your speech function. So you go beyond speech. What is the power behind that speech? That is called as Brahman. Nedam yadidam upasate. Idam. Idam means this. This means the world. In this world, what the people worship here, maybe he is pointing out a fire or something there, which is in the settings, the student and the masters, they are sitting there. And so they are talking about idam. Two times it is used, because one is used to represent the idol which is there in this world. Any world, any idol which is used in this world, not this what people worship here. Not this what people worship here. He is going to say this every mantra. Again I am saying, it is not to condemn the worship. It is talking to a level of the Upanishadic students to whom he has made them understood what Brahman is. And he says, you go through the subjective worship of what makes you speak. Worship that as Brahman, not what people worship here. That is why this is given twice here. That which cannot be expressed by speech, that by which speech is expressed, know that alone to be Brahman, not this. This which people worship here. Mantra 6. Sir. Yes.
Sir, this is almost more or less similar to the neti neti which is explained in some other Vishnika. Now the question is, what is the ultimate that this is trying to say? In the sense that anything you are trying to think about or that Hindu Brahman, so what this, no not this, this, no not this.
then everything is negated. What remains is some people call shunyavad, is emptiness, void. Now there some of the philosophies end there, but some people also question further, who is seeing this void? Who is seeing? Jiva is seeing this void. So there is something which is beyond this void. So likewise, when you go to that ultimate, the last point, what is it that this is actually going to become?
In fact, it is continuation of that neti neti only. So it is negating first of all the perception, emotion and thought of the external world. Then you, as you said, all this external world, it is not there or there. Who is seeing? I am seeing. Therefore, I am there. So therefore, the question arises as to who am I? In who am I also? Am I this body? Neti. Not that. Remove it. Am I this mind? No, not that. Remove it. Am I this intellect? Am I this prana? Inside. No. Remove. What makes us all function is a conscious entity to which you attribute that quality I. That is what you are. That is what you are. So this is talking about that upasana aspect. Neti can be, of course, that is also upasana. Atmabodha says, I think, neti neti iti vakyataha. By negating that which is not Brahman and asserting that which is Brahman is the form of worship. When that is turned subjectively inside, that is what this Upanishad is finally trying to say. So it is ultimately negating all that is not Brahman and giving us a formula by which that which is not really Brahman, but which you experience, all that is made possible because of the functioning of the Brahman. So therefore, try to go through your own source to find out that you will hit that self. For that is this sadhana given.
When Jiva says, you is experiencing this what another thing, but when you say that he is negating body, he is negating his mind, he is negating all these the concepts and other things, ultimately what is that? He is the pure consciousness as it is.
Yes.
Okay. Now the thing is, why does he not get it? Because of avidya. Not knowing that he himself is that. So is this negativity hitting at that point, or is it going beyond somewhere else?
No. By negating everything, your thought comes to that single pointed focus. You are not exactly knowing what it is, but your thought is lingering around that. So that thought becomes stronger and stronger. Then by the formula of as you think, so you become, you hit it. That's it. Yes, sir.
You said beyond known and known. There things it is cannot be known. But we also are saying in some way that this needs to be experienced. But should this not be beyond experience also?
Yes. Experience is the closest word that we can use. Realize, experience, enlighten. All these are words. Experience contains three factors. The experiencer, the experienced and coming together, which is experience. All these three merge into one there. So there is absolutely no way to describe it. So it is not experience also. So you can use any word that you want. It conveys the same. Mantra 6.
Yan manasana manute yena hurmano matam tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yadidam upasate yan manasana manute yena hurmano matam tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yadidam upasate.
That which cannot be visualized by the mind, that by which the mind visualizes. So they say, know that alone to be Brahman, not this which people worship. So now he is exactly using the same meaning with reference to mind. So mind seems to function independently, but it is not so. The external organs, like organs of perception and organs of actions, these are all very sort of easy to understand and relate to. That's why we gave the example also, you break this pinna and go inside, you will still be able to hear all those things you can do. But mind is little difficult to understand. That I am not the body is even practically understood by everybody at the time of death. Because we see that somebody was using this body and he has left the body. That body is lifeless and it has no this thing. But I am not this mind is very difficult to conceive. Swami Ramtirtha says, when you keep a blue cloth against a crystal ball, the crystal appears blue. But blueness is not attributed to crystal. And you can easily prove it. How? Remove the crystal, remove the cloth, and you know that crystal is colorless, pure. Blue belongs to this here. But he says, technically speaking, go further and analyze whether that blue thing belongs to the cloth. No. The cloth is actually white cotton or something. Upon by the process of dyeing and various other things, that they have made that blue superimpose itself upon the cloth. But how to show it? It is impossible or next to impossible. You have to use various chemical processes to remove the blueness out of the cloth and show that blue is different. You see, in the water blue is there, but cloth is white. But you need a hard soap, let us say. That unless the hard soap of Vairagya is not there, we will not be able to segregate the mind and Atman and able to show. Because we saw in that reflection diagram also, it is on the mind that the consciousness reflects. So, as the mirror and the reflected sun are impossible to segregate, but yet mind is an instrument. One of the proof, or rather a point to think about, is when you are sleeping, when the prana is there and you are alive, mind is not there. Somewhere it goes, and when you wake up, from somewhere it comes. But in and through sleep, something else is there. Something else is there. That is what is making you recall the sleep. And we know memory is the function of consciousness. So these are the pointers for us to think about whether consciousness and mind is the same or different. So consciousness is different from the mind. It is that which makes the mind think, not what it is thought by the mind. And this thought is given in various Upanishads. Even in Taittiriya Upanishad, it says, where the mind goes and returns back, it cannot reach. It cannot reach. Therefore, it returns back. So that which cannot be thought of the mind, but that which makes the mind think, is Brahman. So therefore, what people visualize, etc., are all still in the realm of experience only, and that is not Brahman. Brahman is beyond that experience. That's what this mantra says. Mantra 7 and 8 taken together.
तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यच्छ्रोत्रेण न शृणोति येन श्रोत्रमिदगो श्रुतं तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यच्चक्षुषा न पश्यति येन चक्षु घोषि पश्यति तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते यच्छ्रोत्रेण न शृणोति येन श्रोत्रमिदगो श्रुतं तदेव ब्रह्मत्वं विद्धि नेदं यदिदमुपासते
That which one sees not by the eye, that by which one's eyes see, know that alone to be Brahman, not this which people worship. That which one hears not by the ear, that by which this hearing is heard, know that alone to be Brahman, not this which people worship. So it is conveying the same meaning here with reference to the organs of perception. Again, eyes and ears are taken to collectively represent all the organs. You can just remember the example in this context of telescope that you can see everything through the instrument of telescope clearly, except the eyes that see through the telescope. So eye, in this example, eye is the subject, telescope is the instrument, and what you see is the object. So what sees, the real subject, cannot be the object of your perception. For mind, you can use the example of a cell in a torch. Same example. If there is a torch light and there is a battery cell and let us say it is getting over, you want to purchase a new battery, you want to purchase the same brand, let us say, and there is no other light, you want to see the brand, you can open the torch and quickly put it, but there will be no light because the light is illumined because of the battery. So the torchlight can illumine everything except the battery. The telescope can show everything except the eye. Like that it is. What makes the eyes see is the Brahman. What makes the ears hear is the Brahman. Now the upasana or worship, as we have mentioned before, I am quickly repeating. Since the organs of perception are open to the world and you have no chance to shut it out, constantly you are receiving stimuli from the world. The subjective way of converting it into worship is, when something strikes you, the focus of attention of an extroverted person is to get involved in what he sees or what he hears. Then he gets involved in it, he may like it, dislike it, get into a moods of happiness or sorrow, all those things is there. But a trained person through his subjective worship, an introvert, will immediately switch his consciousness. In other words, the moment a sound enters your ear, moment a sight enters through your eyes, instead of thinking of what I see, I am just thinking of what makes me see. This way, I am not getting involved in the perception, I am not creating further desires to be in the world and get more and more attracted towards the world. I am rather switching on to the consciousness which makes me see. So that is the thought associated with God. Again, I say this is a subjective worship at the subtler level, at the introverted level, but this is the process. So since we are confronting perception always, see, organs of action, at least you can have a hold and say, I will not act. But perception, relatively, it's not possible. You have to eat something. So the tongue is open, skin is open, eyes you cannot close for ever. Your nostrils and ears, they are open. So world is bound to enter you. They are going to create agitations and disturbances for you. So instead of getting involved in the perceptions, you try to get involved in what makes you perceive. That's what these mantras say. Last mantra, mantra 9.
Yat pranena na praniti yena prana praniyate tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yadidam upasate. Yat pranena na praniti yena prana praniyate tadeva brahmatvam vidhinedam yadidam upasate.
That which one sustains not by the prana, vital air, that by which prana is sustained, know that alone to be Brahman, not this which people worship. This prana is again a matter only. It is that which connects your subtle body and gross body. It is part of your subtle body, but it is that portion of the subtle body which is in contact with the gross body. That is why when a person is dead, they say prana is gone. Prana is gone means prana is gone from the body. Therefore, there is a disconnect. So that what people think is, all this while this Atma was sustained by the prana only. So prana seems to be all powerful. It is not so. He says just the opposite. The prana is sustained by the Atman. It's very interesting. That by which the prana functions, prana. So how do we really understand this? It is difficult. Just think about it again. In the deep sleep state, your pranas are functioning, but you are not conscious of the deep sleep. So prana per se has no consciousness in it. If you want to take a modern example, take this computer. In the computer, what you see is the external organs, right? The monitor, the keyboard, the mouse. What is this of the computer? The body, the gross body. So what is the subtle body? Sorry? Software. This, without the software, the computer will not function. Right from the operating platform, it is the software. Software is invisible. There are certain codes and other things which is entered, it is invisible for you. But without that software, the computer will not function. So software is the this thing. is the subtle body. In your laptop, what is required for computer to operate apart? The battery, right? The battery is the prana. Battery has a lifetime. Our prana also has a lifetime. When the prana's lifetime is over, it is over. But how is that battery charged? That is the important question. Battery is not swayambhu. It doesn't come from the earth like it. Something is charged and therefore the battery gains that power. That power comes from electricity. And remember that electricity is not confined to this computer. That electricity is all pervading, all gadgets, everything like that. So, it has that electricity is cannot be confined to this equipment, but this equipment is useful to understand electricity. So, that which sustains actually the battery, time and again what recharges the battery is that electricity. So, that which makes the battery function is also the same electricity. Electricity is not, battery doesn't give electricity. Battery gives the power to operate this computer. So, this is a very subtle example that we can think about. So, similarly, the physiological functions that are happening within us, the respiratory function, the excretory function, the perception and other natural functions, circulation, thought absorption, nervous system, all this is functioning because of that power inside, that supreme power inside. Understand that to be Brahman, and that is not sustained by this prana. And that is, know that alone to be Brahman, not this, this which people worship. So, this concludes actually the part A, which is the essential Upanishad. Part B is a very interesting five mantras. It is one of the outstanding portion in talking about what is the experience of a realized person. You know, it is a continuation of this. Then the same message given in part A is beautifully given in a story in part 3 and 4. This five mantras, you can listen to it and come, because the what we have repeatedly done all this while, it may be a little difficult to catch on with the chanting of the mantras. So, I would request you to practice the chanting of part 2 mantras for the next class. Yeah.
So, if any incident happens, then you don't react. You cut it as a third person. As you said that if anything happens, you think that what has made it happen rather than the incident itself. So, at times the challenge is that…
No, 1 minute. When you say incident, what we talk about in terms of upasana is in terms of perception. What we say is perception, whether you like it or not, is going to hit. Suppose you say that I don't want to react and anything, even you go to Himalayas, you will be seeing something, you will be hearing something. So, compared to organs of action, organs of perception are more open. You cannot really shut it. So, at the higher level or subtler level, see, the karma yogis convert actions into worship. The jnana yogis convert perception into worship. So, we are talking about converting perception into worship, and that is the chain reaction that is given here. Now, being objective witness of all the incident, that is a separate practice by itself. That is a, so to say that mind gets involved in a fight or a quarrel, or it could be anything, you know. So, why is it that the mind I should get involved? Why not see it as a third person? So, being a witness in each and every, that's what second part is going to say. Second part, fourth mantra is very powerful. It is going to say, by being a witness to this, not getting involved in it, you are carrying on with your duty in the world, but not being a party to it, that I am something else. This is a practice of being a witness by itself.
So, exactly that point, sir. By not getting involved in being a witness, the challenge comes in day-to-day life is the time you start feeling, are you doing enough? You start questioning yourself that you are not getting affected by it. So, maybe your desired action is not enough. So, I mean, that becomes a big challenge in life, in day-to-day life. So, one doesn't know that if you are not reacting, you should react or not, or any problem, are you attending to the problem in the proper way? So, that kind of intellect…
Correct. In fact, what you are asking is essentially the difference between detachment and indifference, in a way. Am I being completely indifferent and not attending to the problem at all?
Yeah, or I have the intellect to understand the difference.
Correct. That is where the sattvic intellect has to develop to understand. Otherwise, we will be thinking, meaning a tamasic person can understand himself to be very sattvic. That is not the case. So as you grow the intellect, you will automatically know. That is how it will happen. So you have done your best and yet you are aloof from the results because of your detachment. Be it the best praise given to you or the worst criticism given to you, you are able to take it evenly. That is a practice. So that comes with the development of intellect only. We'll conclude with the bhajans here.
Shanti.